I don't know if you've ever had a discussion with somebody who's asked you a question, but it's very clear that they're just not interested in your answer. Have you ever had that experience? I was reading a Facebook thread this week, and boy, by the time I'd finished, I wanted to take a bath. I felt filthy having read it. Just the way the people were conducting themselves. I wanted to commit violence upon inanimate objects. It was so frustrating reading this account. And what had happened is somebody had said something controversial, I know, on the internet. Weird, right? But everyone was then weighing in and having their say and discussing with this person. But the person who had put this thing out there, they just weren't listening. They just weren't listening. They would not engage with what other people were saying. They only wanted to hear one thing. They weren't interested in engaging. They weren't interested in changing minds. They were just interested in being right. I don't know if you've ever experienced that. And I wonder if we're all honest with ourselves, if we'd be honest enough to say, well, we've done that too. Or maybe it's just me. And I'm going to put myself out there this evening for your righteous condemnation. But I don't know if maybe you've ever asked somebody to do something. Maybe you've asked your wife to, iron a shirt for you. And you see that the shirt you've requested to be ironed hasn't been ironed. And instead of just, getting it and doing it yourself, or, helpfully bringing it to her and asking, would you mind doing this? Instead, you leave it where it is. Pretend you haven't seen it and go, oh, love, have you ironed that shirt for me? You know that question, don't you? You know full well what the answer is. You're not looking for an answer. You know the answer. You're looking to be right. You're looking to be judgmental. What a horrible thing to do. Who would do such a thing? Well, that sort of question is exactly what we see the Jewish leaders doing here to Jesus. Look at verse 2. Tell us by what authority you do these things, or who it is that gave you this authority. This isn't a genuine question from the Jewish leaders, is it? They're not interested in learning. They're not interested in finding out more about God, about Jesus. They have no interest in learning from Jesus where he's received his authority. In fact, the question here that they've asked really has nothing to do with authority at all. But their question instead has everything to do with killing Jesus. This was a question designed to kill Jesus. This was a question designed to make Jesus say something in response, which would turn the hearts and minds of the people against Jesus. And so we'd provide them with the political cover, the PR cover, to do what they wanted, which was kill him and get rid of him. They weren't interested in learning from Jesus in this question. They were interested in winning. And they were interested in being proved right. And we know what that's like. We've either received it or we've done it. And it's an ugly thing to do to each other, isn't it? It's an ugly thing to be that proud. But you know what? It's a dangerous thing to do when we do it with Jesus. It doesn't really surprise us, does it, to see the Jewish leaders doing this here? It's no surprise to see them acting in this way. This is throughout the Gospel of Luke, we've seen them acting in this way, consistently and persistently trying to trip up Jesus, opposing Jesus and his ministry, looking for ways to catch him out. And so they come to him while he's teaching in the temple, verse 1. One day, as Jesus was teaching the people in the temple and preaching the gospel, so imagine what it would be like to hear Jesus preaching the gospel. The chief priests and the scribes with the elders came up and said to him. So he's there, he's teaching the people in the temple, and this group comes up. And I want us just to notice this about this group. Here we have the chief priests, the scribes with the elders. These are three distinct groups that are represented here in this one group. The chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. They were three groups which were really quite different in their practice and their theology. There was often infighting amongst these groups. They didn't always get on. They didn't always agree. But they are united in this thing, aren't they? They are united in their desire to kill Jesus. And this tells us something. This tells us something about them, about their hearts and their motives. You see, these leaders who couldn't agree on a breakfast order are united in this. We want to see Jesus dead. They couldn't agree on much, but could agree on this. If that doesn't tell us how far from God Judaism was. You know, we can't agree on the exact application of this minutia of the law. We'll fall out on areas of theology. But surely, surely we can come together to kill the Son of God. Surely we can all agree that we need to kill the Messiah. They've been trying to catch him out for months now. And finally, the heat has really been turned up, is what we see here going forward. In fact, in verses 1 to 44 of chapter 20 alone, we see five confrontations, five controversies or complaints from the Jewish leaders against Jesus. Five ways they try to catch him out. It's heating up. We're getting towards the cross. The enemy is agitated. And it begins here in the temple with the request to reveal the source of his authority. Tell us by what authority you do these things. Well, what are the these things they're talking about? What is it they take issue with? Well, really, it's everything, isn't it? Everything that's gone before. Of course, it's his teaching. He's teaching the gospel. What gives you authority to teach the gospel in this way? It is, of course, a reference to his miracles and more than that, isn't it? We've seen in the past couple of weeks in Luke, we've seen something of the what we might call the inner life of Christ. Both with Steve last week and Pastor Rich 2 weeks ago. They've really helpfully taken us to the scriptures and through the scriptures. And they've shown us something of the emotion of Jesus. That inner life, that emotion, his love for his people. And we've seen his intense love for the lost as he approaches Jerusalem and he weeps over it. And he's just broken as he considers what awaits Jerusalem in their rejection of him. And then, of course, driven by that love, and it's a love that drives him, driven by that love, driven by that desire to see people turn to him and come to life and to avoid the judgment of God, he's furious then to see that the place that was designed to do that, the place that was designed to bring people to God, the place that was created to bring people into a saving knowledge of God, had instead been turned into a den of robbers. Had been used to line the pockets of the leaders instead of being a place where God was at the center. And so Jesus forcefully drives out the vendors. And if it's anything like the last time we hear of Jesus cleansing the temple, no doubt it would have involved turning over tables, knocking over stands. It wasn't necessarily what we would consider polite. So Jesus clears out the temple and instead replaces God, the Word, back at the center of the temple, himself. He is the Word of God, isn't he? And he places himself there in 1947, chapter 1947, and he was teaching daily in the temple. He clears out everything else. Jesus, the Word of God, he is the one. He is the Word of God. He is the one who is perfectly at home in the temple. And he has the authority to do these things, the clearing out, the teaching, the miracles. And so when they ask where his authority comes from, what they're really saying is, on what authority do you have that you mess up our temple? We had a good thing going here. And Jesus' answer, of course, although he doesn't voice it here, the answer is, mine, my authority. I am the Word, the living Word, and this is my house, this is my Father's house. Jesus is a self validating authority. We understand authority is given to us from others. That's the way it works, isn't it? But not for God. He is authority. He is God. Jesus had an authority like no other. Read in Matthew 28:18. Jesus said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. All authority. The authority to make life. He was there in the beginning. He is the creator and the authority to take life. The authority to stop the laws of physics that he himself has set into place. To cause the sun to stand still. The authority to come back from the dead. We understand authority, but this is beyond us. We can't begin to comprehend the authority that Jesus has. This is what it means to be absolutely sovereign. This is what it means to answer to no one outside of yourself, to have all authority. And the chief priests, scribes, and elders ask, by what authority do you do these things? It's an incredibly impertinent question to ask the living God. What gives you the right, Jesus? And of course, the answer is the one given to me by my Father. The authority I share with my Father, the one I exerted at the beginning of the world to bring all things, including you, into existence. Jesus has ultimate authority, and it is a self-validating authority because he is God. The things he did, the miracles he did, were a validation of his authority. And what's more, the crowd clearly recognize that he is God, don't they? Well, they recognize his authority, should I say. They don't fully get that he is God, perhaps at this point, but they certainly at least get he is from God. They understand something of his authority. They get it, don't they? Last week we read in verses 47 to 48, this is after he'd cleared out the temple, and he was teaching daily in the temple. The chief priests and the scribes and the principal men of the temple were seeking to destroy him, but they did not find anything they could do. For all the people were hanging on his words. So Jesus comes and he smashes up this market, which is popped up in the temple. And what's the response of the people? They hang on his every word. Now let me ask you, if a man comes into Tesco's and trashes the place, you don't look at such a man and go, wow, I've got to hear what he has to say. Of course not. And yet this is people's, their response to Jesus. They see what he does because they see not madness in his actions, but they see authority. They see the right. They see the consistency of his words and his actions, and they recognize something of his authority. And so the next two chapters, chapters 20 and 21, are a record of the teaching that the people received from Jesus in the temple during this Passion Week. It's thought that chapter 20 alone actually is one day's worth of teaching. That the same day that we're talking about now. The people are listening to him, and the leaders want to kill him. So how are they going to do it? How are they going to kill Jesus and yet still keep the people on their side? Because they felt they needed to. Because they had no conviction. It was a political move. They needed the people to support them, to prop them up with their money and other such things. So what's their plan? Well, let's make him say something so controversial, so blasphemous, that not only will they let us kill him, but they'll help us. I know. Let's get him to say that he's God. Let's get him to say that. They ask the question not because they're interested in the answer, but because they want to win. Because they want to win. Let's just consider Jesus' response then. Because Jesus answers their question, doesn't he? But he answers it with a question of his own. Verse 3. He answered them, I also will ask you a question. Oh, you ask me a question, let me ask you a question. Now tell me, was the baptism of John from heaven or from man? Now what's going on here? Why is Jesus being so evasive, we may ask? Why won't he just answer their question? Doesn't he know the answer? Is he scared to answer them? Why won't Jesus tell the truth? Well, of course, Jesus is not being evasive here. It's not that he couldn't answer their question. It's not that he's too scared to answer their question. In fact, we see later in Luke's gospel at the end of chapter 22, when the chips are down, when they're really down, he answers that question full on, knowing exactly what it means. It's not that he's scared. It may be that it's not quite time yet. That might be an answer. And so Jesus answers in a way which was common in rabbinic debate. He answers with a question, and nobody listening would have thought he was being rude or evasive. They got it. This is the way it worked. And we need to remember, of course, that Jesus knows why they're asking this question. It was patently obvious what they were trying to do. And so his response pushes past their question to expose and deal with the heart behind the question. You see, Jesus could have, of course, answered their question quite easily, but he had an appointment with the soul of those who were asking it. He could have dealt with it and moved on, but he had an appointment with their souls. And so, and this is what Jesus does, doesn't he? We've seen it before elsewhere in Luke, and we see it in our own lives as well. You see, Jesus, he's not an information booth. He isn't interested in just giving us information about him. He does, and we're grateful for it. But Jesus' desire isn't that we would know about him, but that we would know him. That we would know him. And so Jesus will answer our question in the same way he answered their question, in a way that will bring that about. It's not just about information. It's about changing us. He'll answer our questions in ways that will tear down barriers and will deal with sin. And we could easily dismiss Jesus as being evasive or trolling them or, anything like that. But he's not playing games here. Jesus isn't being political here. He's exposing their hearts. He's exposing them. Let's just look at his question, at this question and answer in its fullness, verse 3. So he answered them, "I also will ask you a question. Now tell me, was the baptism of John from heaven or from man?" And they discussed it with one another, saying, "Well, if we say from heaven, he will say, well, why did you not believe him? But if we say from man, all the people will stone us to death, for they are convinced that John was a prophet." So they answered that they did not know where it came from. Of course, the John that Jesus speaks of here is John the Baptist. John the Baptist was born shortly before Jesus, and his job, as we know from Scripture, his job was to prepare the way, prepare the people for the coming Messiah, which he did by calling them to a baptism of repentance. The people would hear John's preaching, they'd hear about the coming Messiah, they'd hear about their need to be ready for him, and they'd respond to his preaching by going down into the river with him and being symbolically washed, symbolizing a cleansing of sin, of making ready for the Messiah as they awaited him. And the people recognized John's authority as a prophet. They recognized the authority in his preaching, and many were baptized. So this prophet who many acknowledged as such, what was his assessment of Jesus? And this is why it's important to realize why Jesus is asking this question. What's this prophet's assessment of Jesus? "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." That's what John had to say about Jesus. And after he had baptized Jesus, of course, many who were there would have seen a dove, the Spirit like a dove, resting upon him, and a voice from heaven saying, "This is my Son, with whom I'm well pleased." And so Jesus asked the leaders, John's ministry, all that went on? Was it of God or was it of man? These things that John did and said, including what he said about me, did he say it with the authority of God or did he say it with the authority of man? How do they respond? Well, they've already responded, actually, haven't they? We see in Luke chapter 7, we read that the Pharisees and the lawyers, symbolically the leadership, rejected the purpose of God for themselves, having not been baptized by him. They'd rejected John's baptism already. Why did they reject John's baptism? And this is important as we go forward. Because it would have meant acknowledging that they were not saved. If they'd accepted John's baptism, it would have been an acknowledgement that they were not already saved. The baptism of John was a proselyte baptism. It was asking a Jew to treat themselves as a Gentile. Because this sort of baptism was the kind of baptism that was used when Gentiles, non-Jewish people, wanted to join the Jews in their worship. And so receiving this baptism from John was an acknowledgement that you were not okay. That you were not safely one of God's people already. That you needed to be washed to join them. That you were in need of saving. And there was no way that the Jewish leadership were ever going to do that. So they know they can't answer, well, from heaven. They cannot say John's ministry was from heaven, because that would give John and his baptism validity. and would rightly call the question, well, why weren't you baptized by him then? But equally, they know they can't say of men, because all the people around them recognized John as a prophet. They were convinced that John was a prophet, and therefore they would be stoned for blasphemy. If they said John was not of God, they'd be stoned for blasphemy. And so the response they're left with is a politician's answer. No comment. Verse 7. So they answered that they did not know where it came from. Don't know. Don't want to say. It's quite childish, really, isn't it? More than childish, it's shameful. It's shameful. It's sad and it's shameful. These were meant to be the spiritual leaders of the people. And when asked about a teaching and a ministry of a well-known teacher and preacher, one who was in their area, who was teaching their people, they cannot recognize the source of his authority. They cannot recognize the source of his teaching. They cannot discern whether this teaching is sound. Or worse, they can, but they choose not to say. They choose not to say. They refuse to nail their colors to the mast and lead their people. They have no conviction. They are not convinced and they are not convincing. They are completely disinterested in spiritual things. All they're interested in is winning, is being a politician. That's what's going on here. And I want us to think about how this applies to us. How does this passage, how does this interaction speak into our own lives? And first of all, as we come to thinking about our application, I want to say this. In our times, in our day, disinterest has become an art form. Disinterest has become an art form. And guys, let me say, the younger you are, the better we are at it. Let's be honest. It's not cool to be interested. It's not cool to have conviction. If you're convinced of something which isn't popular, well, you might as well murder your social life. Apathy is cool. Viewing things with contempt is cool. Being completely disinterested in spiritual things is cool. But let me tell you, it's going to get you killed. It's going to get you killed. Disinterest is not cool. It's stupid. It's foolish. So listen up and get interested. We have to be convinced. We have to be convinced of who Jesus is. Amen. The leaders fail to come to a conclusion because they didn't like the outcome, what it would mean for them, either way. If they were truly convinced that John's baptism was from man, which it seems that's what they believed, if they were truly convinced of it, thus proving that Jesus is a blasphemer, they faced death. But they were not convinced enough. They did not have the courage of their convictions to say that. But neither could they be convinced that John's baptism was of God, because that too would have implications for them. It would have meant that they were not saved. They were not safe. It would have meant that they were not one of God's people. For all these years, they've been walking around and acting as though they were. Are they suddenly going to jump in the water and say that they're not? I don't know. I've known Christians like that. They've got to a point in their life where everyone's so convinced that they are a Christian. They've been in church every week. They serve. And the bearing of the gospel comes in their life and they realize they're not. It takes a lot of pride. It takes a lot of swallowing your pride to say, do you know what? I've just become a Christian. I know you thought I've been one for 30, 40 years, but I've just become a Christian. But that's what they needed to do. They would not allow their pride. They would not swallow their pride and do that. That would be a warning to us. And so rather than look into these things, rather than leaders looking into who Jesus was, rather than looking into John's ministry and becoming convinced one way or another, they instead remain in their own ignorance. And they just believe what they want to. They believe what suits them, what makes them comfortable, because it's palatable to them and it's the easiest thing to do, to say something that they will never be asked to back up to the hilt. And so tonight, the call on you and on me is that we should be convinced. We must be convinced. The call is to become convinced in three ways. Convinced in your heart, convinced in your evangelism, and convinced for the last day. Convinced in your heart. Don't be political with Jesus. No comment won't cut it. The leaders in the temple didn't want to answer because of what it would mean for them. We thought about that. One answer meant swallowing their pride. The other answer meant facing death. And so it is for you when you come to Jesus. Two same things on either hand. To acknowledge that Jesus is who he said he was is acknowledging that you need help. Is acknowledging that you have sinned, that you have failed, that you need rescuing, that you cannot do it by yourself. It means confessing that God is the one who has made you, who loves you, who's called you, who saved you, and therefore who has a claim on your life. That's something we don't like to admit in our natural mind, because it means that we owe our love, our devotion to someone other than ourselves. And that doesn't go down well. Not today. But if you become convinced, that means swallowing your pride to be convinced that Jesus is who he says he was. But if you have become convinced in your belief that Jesus is someone other than he says he was, either, you know, the classic one we hear is, you know, really, we're left with three broad options. Either he was a liar, or he was a madman. That's two, that's not three, I can't count. Either he lied, or he was mad, or he was bad, malicious. And I think we can see from his life that wasn't the case. But if you're convinced that he was one of those things and not who he said he was, well then, you don't have to swallow your pride, but it will lead to death. To reject Jesus is to reject life. To reject Jesus is to reject his offer of salvation. And so you better be convinced of it. You better be convinced. There's a lot at stake here. Me and my cousin, he was a couple of years older than me, and he had a friend at school. He was a non-Christian friend. He was a really good guy, nice guy. But he was adamant that we were wrong about Jesus, and that he was absolutely right. And he would, he'd tease us and he'd mock us and whatever. My cousin said to him one day, look, you know, if you're right that there's this life and then there's nothing, that's it. Well, I haven't really wasted anything, have I, by living a Christian life? I haven't wasted anything, I've got nothing to lose, and neither have you. But if I'm right, well, do you know what? I'll still be okay, because I've got Jesus. But if I'm right, you've got everything to lose. Are you convinced that Jesus really isn't who he said he was? Are you willing to bet your life on it? Do you know that friend is now a pastor? We were right. Sorry, it's not about being right. No, it's not. But he's a pastor now. Isn't that wonderful? Because he looked into it. He looked into it in order to become convinced. He didn't ask questions of the Bible and ask questions of Jesus that were just designed to confirm what he already thought. You know, those red herring questions, you know, did Adam have a belly button? Can God create something so heavy he can't lift it? He didn't ask those questions. He asked real questions with a heart to not just know more about Jesus, but to know him. If he was there, if you're there, I want to know you. There are people, and there may be some of you listening to this either tonight or online, who dismiss Jesus, who dismiss the gospel, who dismiss the Bible. But let me ask you, have you really looked into it? Have you read the Bible? Have you sought to know the truth? Have you prayed? Have you asked God to reveal himself? If you've done all that and you've become convinced still that it's all nonsense, if you've done all those things and you're convinced that it's still nonsense, well, I can at least respect that. I will weep for you. I will pray for you. But I can respect that you've done the work to become convinced. But let me say, if you'll never read the Bible, if you'll never pray and ask for help in understanding, and quite frankly, guys, if you believe this, if it's all mumbo jumbo, then what's the harm in praying? If you've never done those things because it would mean swallowing your pride, well, you're fooling yourself and you're being foolish. You're missing out on life and on joy and peace. Won't you at least take the time to become convinced? To find out if he's there? Become convinced. One way or the other. Because no comment is not enough. We need to be convinced in our hearts. Having become convinced in our hearts, then we must now become convinced in our evangelism. We must have conviction. Let me say, how terrible to be like those leaders who should have known, those leaders who lived and worked around the temple, who studied the scriptures, who people looked at them and thought of them as knowing God, and yet had nothing meaningful to say to the people. Nothing. They were unable to discern the gospel, and they were unwilling to speak it. Let me ask, I know many of you here tonight will say you are convinced of the gospel. Are you convinced of the gospel? Do you know Jesus to be Lord? Do you believe that he is the only way to be saved? Do you believe that the only way to be saved is through Jesus and Jesus alone? He is the only way to know God. He's the only way to have life. Are you convinced of that? Are you convinced that outside of that life in Jesus is nothing but death? And that without repenting and turning to him, a person is hellbound? Do you believe that? Are you convinced of that? Do you not see that to be convinced of those things, to believe them, and yet say nothing? Do nothing? Is to show a callousness and a coldness towards people that brings into question whether you really do believe these things. Being convinced, we then need to be convincing. Not by clever ways, not by political answers, not with witty retorts, but by showing people Jesus, by living as though we love him, by living as though we know him. Sometimes our believing friends can ask those red herring questions. The type of question that the leaders ask here. The type of question that isn't designed to find out more, but is just designed to start an argument. It's designed to win. Let me say, we need to have wisdom to be able to identify those sorts of questions and either dismiss them, and that's fine. Those questions aren't going to lead them to Jesus. Dismiss those questions, or better, do what Jesus does and ask a counter question that pushes through to the heart behind the question. I know I've heard this one. Do you really believe that the universe was made in 6 days? You could spend all day trying to answer that one with somebody who doesn't believe, somebody who doesn't even believe there is a God. Or you could say, look, if I could prove uncategorically that it was, that it was true, if I could prove it to you, would you follow Jesus? No, because you can't, will be the answer. Science is against you. And they're right, because Western science, the rules of it are designed to disprove God. Real science isn't, but Western science is. That's a whole other thing, but we'll get there another day. Science is a good place. You know, those discussions are good to have with people, but they're not the place to start, is my point. Instead, you say, okay then, what is it that you really want to know? You've asked that question, but what is it that you really want to talk about? Because I think the question you really want to talk about is, how can I know that God is really there? That's what you're asking when you ask that question. How can I know if God is really there? Well, let me tell you about Jesus. He's the one who reveals God to us. That's what you're really asking. No one becomes a Christian because there are some young earth scientists with good biblical science. I count myself one of them. But no one becomes a Christian because of that. People get saved because they meet with Jesus. And people become convinced that he is the way to know God. When people ask, well, why is there suffering in the world? Why would God, a God of love, why would a good God allow suffering? Oh, that's a big one. That's not such a bad one. But you reply, well, why do you think there's suffering in your life? Let's never mind a theoretical, what's going on in your life? Why do you ask that question? What is the suffering in your life? Well, let me tell you about the one who suffered for you. The one who suffered and died for you. And this is a common one. Well, God is not all powerful if there is something he cannot do. God is not all powerful if there's something he cannot do, and God cannot lie, therefore God is not all powerful. More of a philosophical one, which is always a nice change of pace. But the question you ask them is, well, where in the Bible does it say God is all powerful? Find me those words out of God's mouth. Okay? You won't, by the way. Not quite in that sense. Where in the Bible does it say God is all powerful? Oh, I don't know. Why don't you read it? Have you read the Bible? No. And then you say to them, well, the Bible never uses that sort of terminology. Not in that way. It talks about God's authority. It talks about his sovereignty. And the reason that God won't lie, by the way, is because it's against his own nature. He is truth. And so he wills. He chooses not to act against himself. He chooses not to lie. Instead, he chooses to love. He chooses to be true. He chooses to be good. And the Bible tells us that this good God can only be known through Jesus. You see that little circle? Come back around all the time to Jesus. Jesus, who is the exact image of God. And that means that when we look at Jesus, we see what God's really like. We see what his power is really like. And his power and authority is to lay down his life and to take it back up again. That's the ultimate way that God shows his power, at the cross, in self-sacrificing power. The God you just asked me about, I don't really know. The God I know is the one who has self-sacrificing power. Power and authority that is used for your good. We need to be convinced so that we may be convincing. And that, what we need to be convincing people is convincing people of Jesus. Introducing people to Jesus. Not convincing them of our Christian issues. Creation, it's important. I believe in a 6-day creation. It's not where I start. It was once. And do you know what? I was the king of arguments. How many people were saved? None. Not through that way. It's not where I start. Abortion is a serious issue. And it breaks my heart. And it breaks the heart of God. But it's not where we start in evangelism. Moral behavior is important. Page after page of the Bible is devoted to calling God's people to godly life. And people who aren't God's people. But that's not where we start in evangelism. It's not where we start. We start with Jesus. We introduce them to Jesus. And once they know him, all these other things, they fall into place eventually. And what I want to say then is evangelism is not campaigning. Evangelism is not campaigning. We mustn't have a campaigning attitude, because campaigning is convincing somebody of your position. Evangelism is convincing people about Jesus. If you are convinced the gospel is true, you will preach the gospel. You will tell the people. You will be convincing. We need to be convinced in our hearts so that we may be convinced in our evangelism, because, and we're going to finish with this, we need to be convinced for the last day. We need to be convinced for the last day. When you stand before God Almighty, ruler of heaven and earth, and you are asked, how do you come? On what grounds do you stand? No comment. will not do. On that day, you will be convinced of God, of his goodness, of your sinfulness. And if you are Christ's, you will be safe. And if you are not, you will not be. It's as simple as that. You might not like that. You might not believe that. But I'm telling you, it's true. You might not like it, but it's true. Who is Jesus? Who is he to you? Do you know him? Do you want to know him? Will you turn to him? Will you call out to him? Do you believe in him? If you want to answer some of those questions tonight, come and speak to me. Come speak to Rich, to one of the other elders, but come and speak to somebody. Because no comment won't cut it. On Friday, we had the funeral of our sister Angela. Angela was convinced of these things. And so Angela, when the Lord called her home, she stood before God Almighty, confident in Jesus. Confident that Jesus is who he said he is. And had done for her what he said he'd done for her. She was convinced of the gospel. And that brought her peace. When we went to see her a few days before, and Rich mentioned this on Friday, it's worth mentioning again. When I asked her how she was, she said, "I'm content. I'm content. I'm content that I'm going to be with Jesus." And she said, "I blame you guys because you preach Jesus too much. And I jumped the gun. I can't wait to see him." She was quipping, but that's how she felt. She couldn't wait to be with him. She was convinced of him. That even when she was facing that, she was content because she was convinced. And you know what? You too can know that peace and that assurance. So get convinced. Find out who Jesus is. Don't be political. Don't try and be witty. I know some of you, it's not working for you. Don't remain disinterested. Kill your pride and come to Jesus.